Hello, it's Thursday, 7th of May, nearing 5:50 p.m. here in Seoul. You're watching Arirang's special live coverage of the COVID-19 briefing. I'm Yoon Jung-min. In just a moment, the Ministry of Health and Welfare and the Korea Centers for Disease Control and Prevention will be delivering updates on how South Korea has been handling the COVID-19 situation. The health authorities will be sharing their virus prevention and control system with the global community and answering their questions. Today's briefing is held online and there will be simultaneous English interpretation. So let's go over to the press briefing now as they are just about to start.
COVID online briefing for foreign media jointly organized by MOHW and KCDC. The world is watching Korea for its stable response to COVID-19 situation and to cater to their interests, we decided to hold the online briefing. Today, we're joined by 30 global journalists from 15 countries, including Italy, Japan, and the U.S. through SNS chat rooms real-time. Thank you for your attention and interest. Today is the 109th day since Korea had the first COVID-19 confirmed case on January 20th. For the first month, the spread seemed to be mild. But on February 18th, changed everything drastically. On that day, Daegu had the 31st patient, and mass infection began in Shincheonji Church Cluster and the nearby Cheongdo Daenam Hospital, causing a surge in patient count. Daily confirmed cases peaked at 909, with 7,470 isolated patients for treatment. It was a national pandemic emergency indeed. With the virus still spreading all the way into March, the government implemented the intensive social distancing measure. On April 3rd, 75 days after the index case, the accumulated patient count exceeded 10,000, but finally curbing the surge of the spread. Currently, the daily new confirmed cases are within 10 cases, and patients on isolation for treatment went down to under 1,500. The Korean government is handling COVID-19 stably. Then yesterday, the government shifted the quarantine gear to distancing in daily life. Now, the Korean public and the government are embarking on the new journey, which is a coordination of life as usual and the quarantine. Today, we'd like to share the Korea COVID-19 response's know-how, the lessons learned, and the plan and our vision with the rest of the international community. We will have a 90-minute press briefing, and it will be aired live through YouTube and through SNS. And we provide simultaneous interpretation into English. So I'd like to ask all the viewers from the world to take part. From now on, I'd like to introduce the two special guests. First of all, General Director Son Young-ne from MOHW, and Deputy Director General Kwon Jun-uk from Central Disease Control Headquarters. Thank you for coming such a long way. And I can see that you are sweating a little bit because you were running toward the studio to begin the live briefing on time. So here's today's housekeeping announcements. First of all, we collected questions from the foreign press in advance. So I'd like to ask you to answer those questions. I will play the video showing the journalists asking the questions, so you can answer the questions one after another. And then we will collect and entertain the real-time questions from the Telegram chat rooms from all over the world. Before we begin the online briefing, why don't you introduce yourselves? Where do you work for and what's your role is? After the March 9th first joint government foreign briefing until April 30th, We got a lot of questions from the media throughout the world, and the majority of the questions were directed to MOHW and KCDC. They wanted to know what was the basic system that the Korean government took, and what were your roles? Mr. Sun, please.
So Korea has an organization that is dedicated to deal with those infectious diseases, and that is KCDC. So Mr. Kwon will be telling you about the organization. And since the outbreak of COVID-19, the government has been providing all possible support, and Ministry of Health and Welfare has been providing financial support as well as providing the structural support. And also, all the central government agencies have gotten together to form a pan-government countermeasure support headquarters. So we have this pan-government organization, and under this organization, we have the local governments that are also working together. So in a nutshell, all these different agencies within the government are working together to combat the crisis. So Mr. Son mentioned about the pan-government infection management measure and structure. And so we have the KCDC in there, and also we have the Central Disaster and Safety Countermeasure Headquarters. And so what does that organization do? So in Korea, we have four different levels of crisis alert. And starting from level 1 to 4, KCDC takes responsibility to deal with all this crisis. And the KCDC deals with all these novel infectious diseases and also chronic illnesses and all other kinds of diseases. So we prevent, manage, and control those diseases. And unlike overseas, we also have the laboratories and institutions within the KCDC. So we also play the role of a laboratory. So under the leadership of the Central Disaster and Safety Countermeasure Headquarters, KCDC is dealing with the disease control and prevention matters.
Now the awareness is rising in the sense that we have to approach a new infectious disease like COVID-19 as a security issue. And I think the two, security and the infectious disease, have something in common. Even if there is a small problem, it can affect the all walks of the society. And Korea experienced SARS and MERS a couple of years ago. And before we had the COVID-19 situation, the Korea conducted the drawing board training after establishing the infectious disease task force. How did you do that?
And actually, in 2015, when Ebola outbreak took place, and since 2014, U.S. has been leading, or U.S. established international society called GHS. And ever since then, we have been in the international community acknowledging that health crisis could be a huge security crisis. So the WHO Director General also amended the regulations, and in this way, we have made the level of crisis or infectious disease management level much higher. So many different countries have joined in that movement, like Australia and other countries. So we have been conducting tabletop exercises or germ games. So we did these germ games dealing with the avian influenza. And last year in December, since coronaviruses change very frequently, and SARS and MERS were also types of coronaviruses. So we had foreseen that a novel kind of coronavirus could take place. So in fact, COVID-19 that took place or broke out last year was one of the coronaviruses. So we conducted the germ game using this disease, and it helped us to exercise, to conduct exercise to control and prevent the disease.
Korea is well known to rapidly and transparently responding to the infectious disease outbreak to the media and also to the public.
public. How did you think the open and transparent response of the government affects the public participation? Being open and transparent in the attitude in responding to the infectious disease, how did you think they work? Well, openness and transparency didn't just come along. During the MERS incidents, we experienced the importance of openness and transparency because we got under criticism, and also hospitals were criticized for not opening the information and for not sharing the information with the public. So after that, the law was enacted to mandate opening up of the information when it comes for level 2 or above infectious disease. So after the law was passed, upon necessity, we make it a rule to immediately sharing the information when it's deemed to be related to the public. And also, COVID-19 was not an exception. Our top priority is that we share information on what's going on with the public. So without having the cure or the treatment or the vaccine, so far we have managed COVID-19 very well. And to do that, I think it was all thanks to the public support, and they supported us because of the openness and transparency.
So the voluntary participation of the Korean citizen was hailed by the international press, and it was driven by the transparency and the openness of the government. Korea experienced the COVID-19 wave quite earlier than other countries. In the light of such experience, what is the most important element in blocking an infectious disease, Mr. Song? So there could be different factors. I think we can take three lessons. First is that through the epidemiological surveillance, we have to gather information. So when the spread is growing, textbook tells us to actually stop the epidemiological investigation, but focus on the severe patients. But COVID-19 grew with a huge speed, so it was difficult to shift towards focusing on the severe patients only. So we did not stop tracking the patients. So it was very, very important for us to keep tracking the patients. And the second is very important to carry out the diagnostic tests very actively. Of course, there are some asymptomatic patients, and some patients have longer incubation periods. So it's very important to carry out the diagnostic tests very boldly. For example, there are sanitary facilities, or there are nursing hospitals. In those hospitals, we did carried out testing on all patients residing there. And the third lesson is that at the beginning of the outbreak, this COVID-19 was very contagious, and there were a lot of mild cases. So about 90% of those patients did not have to be hospitalized. So it would be very difficult to hospitalize all of them. That would be a waste of some finances, budgets, and we wouldn't have enough beds for all of them. So for the mild or for mild cases or for asymptomatic cases, it's very important to build a structure to handle them. So in Korea, there are a lot of hotels or the training facilities. So we utilize those facilities to house those mild cases and manage them. So we efficiently utilize our medical resources. So these three lessons are very important for us.
So the medical system of each country should not collapse, and simultaneously we need to rapidly diagnose and treat the patients. If there is a contagion or the outbreak, we can make the best use of the existing facilities, such as the accommodation centers or the training centers. And the next question is that experts predict that the COVID-19 situation will be prolonged, but we need to revive the social and economic activities. And while doing that, how do you plan to prevent the spread of the infectious disease? Yes, I think it's inevitable to come back to the daily activities in the society and the economy. That's why we coined a new concept called distancing in daily life. We are shifting gears to life as usual while having the distancing. So we are going back to the normal life, but it's a bit different from the life that we had before the COVID-19. We still emphasize on social distancing, but the basic concepts of the social distancing will be coordinated with the daily life, such as when you are waiting in line, you need to have at least 1 meter distance from the person next to you, and then you need to wear face masks. So basically, it's about preventing the spread of COVID-19 virus, so that even if we have a second wave of COVID-19, the spread, the speed of the spread will be remarkably slow. And whenever we have a confirmed case, the Center for Disease Control will diagnose and find the patient, and while containing the disease, we'll be able to lead a daily life as it is. That is what we call distancing in daily life.
So I have some additional questions for you. So there were new terminologies that showed up, such as social distancing or having physical distances, or also the distancing in daily life. Could you give us the definition of those terms? First of all, social distancing is a very functionally, very well-known term. In order to prevent an infectious disease in within a society, sometimes some societies lock down the cities or shut down some of the facilities and also move some of its residents to other places. So there are some very extreme cases of social distancing. But in case of Korea, we did not go to that far. We actually carried out a campaign of social distancing. So we recommended, suggested people to voluntarily participate in social distancing, not have social gatherings, and etc. So that's what social distancing means in Korea. And also, social distancing in daily life is quite new to us. It means going back to normal daily routine, going back to work, and enjoying sports, arts, and culture. But at the same time, doing and following all the rules to prevent the spread of COVID-19, so having the coexistence of preventing the disease and actually carrying out the daily routine. In terms of textbook definition, these aren't structured definitions yet. These are the novel new definitions that we came up with.
The Korean government is changing a couple of days ago from social distancing to distancing in daily life. And I think it's worth your attention to have a reference. From now on, we'd like to answer the questions we previously collected from the foreign media. We're joined by a foreign press.
That was the government briefing on COVID-19 for foreign media outlets this afternoon. We will be back with our regular news at 7 p.m. Korea time. Thanks for joining us, and bye for now.